I normally wait for the clock, but I think the clock's fast or slow or something. It's not exactly on time. Not the the bell, not the clock, the bell. So, welcome. Another great turnout this morning. Lovely to see you all. How are everybody? How is everybody? How are you all? Okay? Coping all right? The temperature has changed, hasn't it? And I think there's a few more people coming in, after which we'll shut the door. Just let these guys in. So Liverpool playing today? Monday, Arsenal. Is it Arsenal? You confident? Okay, well, as these people are coming in, we'll start with some notices. Okay, NHS test and trace. QR code. So what we're asking is please download the NHS test and trace app. Scan the QR code when entering the church. Please still book in with Karen White. I'm going to have to try this sort of technology. Is over my head, but I'll get. If you don't know what to do, ask Rob Smith because he'll be able to give you more information. Okay, so we have two harvest celebrations next week, not this week, next week. So next Sunday will be a harvest celebration here, a family-friendly harvest celebration, and then for the Wednesday congregation, which is our congregation for. Third age people, and I've been asked to say this, third age people, people who are vulnerable, and their drivers, which is actually one person who wants to be known as a driver, so that we will have harvest celebrations for both those congregations. If you want to bring non-perishable food items, you can, as per normal. We will keep those for 3 days and then pass them on to St. James in the City Church. They have a thing going there called the Good Neighbours Project, and where they actually take out food to people's houses. And I think over the coming months, you know, particularly if, and it's when people start to lose their jobs and that kind of thing, people are going to need help. Okay, so that's do please bring, you know, give generously. If you wanted to, some people, there's an option to give cash. If you wanted to give cash to the Good Neighbours Project, you can as well. Okay. Our annual meeting of parishioners, to remind you, is at, on the 6th of October 2020 at 7 p.m. here in church. To attend that meeting, you must be on the first meeting, you've got to be on the electoral roll. Is that right? Sorry? Church electoral roll or voters list, and then the second meeting, annual parochial church meeting, which follows immediately afterwards at 7:30 p.m. is open to everybody. All right, okay, you've got to be on the church electoral roll for the second meeting. Okay, right. You'd think after 30 years I'd know this stuff, wouldn't you? You would. Nod your heads, please. We all have our weaknesses. Okay, a couple of things that are not there. Today is National Police Memorial Day. I was going to give that as a notice because it's fallen on a Sunday, and we have a number of police connections here in this church. I can see one person who works for Merseyside Police. Rob was a police officer with Merseyside Police for many years. It is particularly poignant today because Matt Ratner, was that his name? No. Sorry? Matt Ratara. The police officer from Croydon who was shot in a police station yesterday. So let us pray for him and for his family. And for the police force, it's a difficult time for police officers. They're under intense pressure. The numbers were, as you know, were cut right down, and they're having to deal with the whole outfall of COVID. So we particularly pray for the families. I think there was eight families over the last 10 years who have lost loved ones, police officers who've been killed, lost their lives in the line of duty, and those who've lost their lives in other ways. Okay, I want to say a few words about school forms. Next week, if you've got a child that's going into secondary school this year and you want to apply for church schools, to bring your forms next week, that's on the 4th, and between the 4th and the 11th, we will look at those forms and fill them in. The forms ask, well, St Hilda's, St Hilda's you need to send to Karen, because that goes, we have to send that directly now. Okay, the forms ask one thing. Okay, before, I'm jumping around here, before I say this, this isn't a good system. Yeah, I don't mind saying this and being on record. It is not a good system, but it's not the system we've chosen. It's down to the schools, not us. And I've been one of the clergy locally, have sought to lobby the schools to make it fairer. And it isn't a good system. But we have to comply with the system as it is. Okay, so the schools will ask variously whether the child particularly has attended weekly, thrice monthly, twice monthly, or monthly. Okay, one of the forms, at least one of the forms, asks for parental attendance as well. Okay, we make that judgment on one thing only, and that is the registers. Okay, so we take registers for Children's Church, and this academic year we have taken a register here of all children coming into the church, if they come and don't go to Children's Church and sit with their parents. We will not be taking into account the period in which we did not meet as a church for worship, okay, during lockdown. But since we've been open, as we are now, we're taking that into account. And we have been able to accommodate anybody who's wanted to come. Okay, so it's based on the registers. You hand your forms in, we will return them and to you in a sealed envelope with the details of the registers. Okay, so you know what we're basing it on. Okay, for obvious reasons, because it's lockdown, because of COVID, there will be no interviews. We may actually do that in the future, because in a sense having interviews is, because it's based on facts, and the facts are in the registers, so actually interviews are not necessary, I don't think. Okay, so going forward, probably not to have. We keep the registers for two reasons, actually. One, for the schools, to keep a record for the schools' applications. But actually, there's a more important reason. We have to keep a register of all children who come into the building for safeguarding purposes. So, okay. Don't think there's anything else to be said about that. And oh yes, just so you know, you'll know what's on the forms if you've seen the forms. It's over a three-year period. So it's attendance over a three-year period. Okay, can you take out your mobile phones? Okay, take them out, hold them up, and say 1 hour. 1 hour, and then turn them off, please, for 1 hour. Thank you. Oh, I'm leading the service today, and Debbie is who's turning her phone off. Is going to speak. Okay. Does anybody not know who Debbie is? Okay. There's a few people who don't know. Debbie is Debbie Lovett is. She'll tell you, but you can tell them a bit. You can tell them a little bit later, maybe. Debbie Lovett is an ordinand, which means she's training for the ordained ministry for my role, and she's on placement with us here until the end of the academic year, after which she will be. in July or somewhere around July, she will be ordained as a minister, as a curate in the Church of England. So she's on placement. A number of you would have seen her online when we did the online services leading. She led two or three of those services. So welcome, Debbie, and it's great to have you with us and to have you speaking to us today. So let's just take a few moments silence to still our hearts and minds, to prepare ourselves to worship Almighty God, who is perfectly revealed to us in the person of Jesus Christ our Lord. We come to meet with him in spirit and in truth. The psalmist wrote, "Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. Let us also seek the way and the truth of God." Praying together. Into the mix of humanity, with friends and neighbours, visitors and strangers, together we join to worship you, our Lord, our God. Amen. So we're unable to sing as normal with our voices, but we can always sing in our hearts. We can always smile with our eyes and sing in our hearts. So we're going to have our first song now, which is a call to worship. Come, now is the time to worship. So we've come now to the time in the service where we bring before God those regrets that we might have for the things that we may have said or done or thought which have offended him or offended our fellow human being. So let's again take a moment's silence to think about our own lives, our own personal failings. We all have those, I have those, Debbie has those. Our failings, our flaws. We bring them before these things, before the cross. The Bible calls these things sin. We lay them before the cross in the assurance that Jesus has paid the price for them on the cross, has given his life for us, and that we can indeed be forgiven, and in him we are forgiven, and will finally be forgiven. Let us say these words together. We sometimes think that the more we have, the happier we will be. If only, then all will be well. We sometimes turn the other way, closing our eyes and our ears, ignoring what we see, choosing to neglect those asking for help. Sometimes we refuse a helping hand to those in need. We want to do our thing instead. We do not want to confess these things. But Lord God, in this moment, in this place, in this space that we have been given, give us the desire to confess our failings and our sins. Renew us from within and set us free from all that shackles us. Set us free to be the human beings you would have us be. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Rob will now bring us our reading, which is on a video, I think.
Today's reading is Matthew 21, verses 23 to 32. The authority of Jesus' question. Jesus entered the temple court, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him. By what authority are you doing these things, they asked, and who gave you this authority? Jesus replied, I will also ask you one question, and if you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or of human origin? They discussed it amongst themselves and said, if we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the people, for all they hold that John was a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we don't know. Then he said, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. The parable of the two sons. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons, and he went to the first and said, son, and go and work today in the vineyard. I will not, he answered, but later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, I will, sir, but he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted? The first, they answered. Jesus said to them, truly, I tell you, tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did, and even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Lord, we thank you for the gift of your word. And as we think on these things, Open our hearts and our minds to hear you. Amen. Good morning.
Good morning.
My talk today is in two parts. In the first part, I'll look at the context of the reading that we just heard and what it means. And in the second part, I'll look at how we relate to this. Let's remind ourselves first of what we heard. Jesus is teaching in the temple, and the chief priests and the elders of the people ask him about where his authority or his right to do what he's doing has come from. Jesus asks them a question in return about where John the Baptist got his authority from. And they answer that they don't know. Jesus then tells a parable, a teaching story, of the two sons being asked by their father to help in the vineyard. So, Jesus is in Jerusalem, at the temple, teaching. He's recently arrived in the city, and he'll be there for the Passover festival. It was a triumphal entrance. It was also an odd entrance. Many thought Jesus was coming to overthrow the oppressive regimes of Roman occupation and the religious leaders. But kings and conquerors would lead the battle charge on a horse dressed for battle, not clip, clippity-clop on a little donkey. We celebrate Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem as Palm Sunday. In our church calendar, it leads us into Holy Week and is a week before Easter. After that spectacular arrival, Jesus' presence in Jerusalem was no secret. Everyone would have known that the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee had arrived, and many would try to get around him. As it was Passover, the city would have been busy and crowded for that celebration. So, let's picture Jesus sitting on the floor with people around him, listening intently as he teaches. Up saunter the chief priests and the elders of the people, important people, people with power. And they confront Jesus. Who gave you permission to do these things? It's a rude question. It's as bold, as brash as saying, "What are you doing here? Who are you anyway?" Jesus says he'll answer their question when they answer his question about where John the Baptist got his authority from heaven or human origin. They're faced with a dilemma. They've tied themselves in a knot, and they say, if we say from heaven, he's going to say to us, so why didn't you believe him? And if we say of human origin, we'll have to watch out for that crowd because they all reckon John was a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we don't know. Well then, said Jesus, nor will I tell you by what authority I'm doing these things. The chief priests and the elders have not intimidated Jesus into leaving or into silence. And he goes on to tell the parable of the man with two sons who asks each in turn to go and work in the vineyard. It's a bit of a trick question again. One son says no, but after changing his mind, he does go. The other says yes, But then he doesn't go. It's a trick question, because Jesus is trying to get the chief priests and elders to see that it's okay to change your mind. Saying no to the Father is saying no to God. But changing your mind, repenting, doing a 180, is accepting God and doing what he's asked. In contrast, saying yes to going to work in the vineyard, but then not going, is doing a 180 and rejecting God. The chief priests and elders know the answer to Jesus's question, which of the two did the Father wanted? Did what the Father wanted. They get it right. The first son, they answer, the one who first said no, but then changed his mind. Jesus is illustrating to these important, powerful people that they themselves have a choice, like the sons in the story. So far, they've said no, but they still haven't turned that no into a yes. Jesus presses home the point that even the most despised in society, its prostitutes and its tax collectors, have worked it out and accepted John the Baptist as the one sent by God, fulfilling the prophecies in Scripture and opening the way for the Messiah, for Jesus. But even though the lowest of the low have got it, these men, educated, elite, born to take up positions of responsibility as religious and civic leaders, keep refusing to acknowledge what they have seen. How differently things might have gone if just one of these men had said, "You know what? I reckon you're the one we've been waiting for." Now, the talk in the passage might be about John the Baptist, but of course it still centers on Jesus. He may as well have said, "Who do you think I am?" But he's made it easier for them by focusing on John rather than himself. He prods and pokes them with his story of the two sons, stresses how the tax collectors and prostitutes believe John. But, oh dear, even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him. Everyone, and this is everyone, not just men from the ruling class, has been free to accept Jesus. Some have. And some haven't. The choice has not involved violence or blackmail, control or force of any kind. Yet for some, it has been too hard a choice, especially for those who really should have known better. In the parable, of course, the Father is God, and the vineyard is humanity. Who will accept to go and do God's work on earth amongst the people here? Have any of us ever faced that kind of choice? Might any of us have behaved like one of the sons in that story? Probably we can be like both sons. So, as believers in the risen Lord Jesus, and therefore as the Father's workers in the vineyard of humanity, what can we do about it? How can we change our no to a yes? How do we understand when a yes has actually become a no? And how do we keep our yes going? We do this by nourishing our faith. I suggest we do this by staying plugged in to kingdom ways in three ways: through scripture, through prayer, and through each other. When we gather for church, we are doing all three. Scripture, the Bible, is a great place to start. Some people love to read their Bibles and are very good at doing that regularly. I like to mix and match between reading the Bible and listening to it using the audio option on my app. Prayer. There are lots of resources to help us pray. But I think we all get stuck from time to time. So if you would like some help or suggestions, please do let us know. And if you're a bit bashful about that, you can always use that line, "I'm asking for a friend." Each other. Share your dilemmas. Share your goings on and how you think Jesus may be calling you or trying to get your attention. Talk to your trusty Christian friends. And if you're not used to doing that, get in touch with people you know who are used to doing that. And as above for prayer, you can always ask someone, and you can always say, "I'm asking for a friend." Look at examples in your life and work out when you've been which son. Finally, though, notice that there is a third son in the story. The son who is telling the story. The one who says yes to working in his father's vineyard and who hasn't changed his mind. He's the one to be listening to. He's the one to be watching out for. He is Jesus, and he is the one to follow. Amen.
Okay, thanks, Debbie. I'm just going to ask Debbie a couple of questions. Would you like to know a bit more about Debbie? Because she's got quite an interesting background. Okay, so how long have you lived in Liverpool?
5 years.
And how long have you lived in England this time? 5 years.
5 years.
So where were you before and how long were you there?
We've had lots of adventures, Keith.
Right. So, but you were in the Middle East, right?
We were in the Middle East.
For how long? Well, how long were you there?
A very long time. I'm not very good at the maths on this.
And what did you do there?
I've had a variety of careers, a variety of things have gone on. So after my degree, I studied at Exeter University. I wanted to be a little different. I do accept I maybe went a bit far. So I studied Arabic and Islamic history. I was fascinated by that part of the world. I then met my husband, who is Turkish. So having studied Arabic for many years, I then had to learn another language when we moved back to Turkey together as a married couple. Both our daughters were born in Turkey. After 7 years in Turkey, we needed to move. There were restrictions coming in. I was lecturing at that time, and there were restrictions coming in about the qualifications you needed. Plus, my husband had hit a bit of a glass ceiling. And we moved to a very well-known place called Beirut, which is well-known for all the wrong reasons, but is an absolutely wonderful place. Yeah, there are times when it's not so wonderful, but there we go. So we were there, both my girls were educated in Beirut, but then unfortunately we had to leave. The political situation was such that things were very unstable, and some group, I don't know which group, decided that they didn't like Turkish people at all. And apparently, according to the security forces, my husband's name was on a list of people they wanted to kidnap. Luckily, we were living on the campus, and which meant that he was safe and could be protected. He wasn't even allowed to cross the road to get a coffee or leave the campus. It was a scary time. That forced us to relocate. We relocated to Abu Dhabi for 3 years, and then due to a whole variety of reasons, which on their own stand up to nothing but combined, seemed to be moving us to England. We made the decision that I would come back to England in advance of my husband with the girls, get them into school, get them educated, and meet the criteria for the UK visa system, which the whole system makes it very difficult to bring your overseas spouse into the country. So I needed to be settled and established before we even started applying for that visa.
Okay, and just briefly really, but did you see any warfare when you were in Beirut? Any sort of stuff we see on TV, did you see that firsthand?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We experienced earthquakes in Turkey. I don't like them at all. Like war, there's a build up to it. Earthquakes are just like, let's shake your house. And you go, they are horrific, horrific, horrific things. You never know whether it's a small earthquake locally or whether you've felt part of a big one that's happening somewhere else. Absolutely horrible things. I think they should be banned.
And you've got two daughters. One, your youngest daughter is how old?
Youngest is nearly 17.
And she's at what school?
She's at the studio school in the Baltic Triangle.
And your old
first year sixth
form. That's Layla, right?
Farah's
the young one. Layla's the older one.
Layla's the older one.
And what is she doing?
Layla is about to start teacher training at Liverpool Hope University.
That's great. Okay, should we give Debbie a warm welcome? You sit down now.
Thank you.
I think you pinched my notes.
Your manager.
It's all on the screen anyway. Thank you. Well, we're going to have a song now. This is more of a meditative song, if you like, a quiet song. And again, we're singing in our hearts. The first sort of 20 seconds or so, there's nothing at all. So don't think it's not playing, because it will start to play. So, and there's a candle burning. You can focus on that candle, or you can shut your eyes and just receive.
True.
So let us declare our faith in these creedal words from Paul's letter to the Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. So we have another video now where Karen will lead us in our prayers for this Sunday, and then after that there is a video version of the Lord's Prayer, which is led at the beginning by Justin Welby, our Archbishop of Canterbury.
Lord, we pray that you are able to provide solace and inspiration to those who feel detached from you at this time. Those who feel that you may not be present in their daily lives or find it difficult to turn their thoughts towards you. We pray that they are able to experience your ever-present and glorifying nature. We thank you, Lord, for your patience and grace for all those who feel spiritual crisis in their lives. Most of all, we thank you for being beside us at all times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, there are lots of people in this world that need to be looked after. Please show them your love and help us to care for those who are in need, sick or unhappy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give us honest hearts, O God, and send your kindly spirit to help us confess our sins and bring us the peace of your forgiveness in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Lord, you have given us a rich world where there is enough for everyone, but not for everyone's greed. Help us not to damage or squander your creation, but to share with others and look after for everybody in the future to have as well. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, your Son came to save us and bore our sins on the cross. May we trust in your mercy and know your love, rejoicing in the righteousness that is ours through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for the health workers tending the serious ill, for the scientists working on a vaccination, for the researchers analysing data and identifying trends, for the media outlets working to communicate reality, for the supermarket workers, hygiene and sanitation providers, for the good news stories of recoveries and effective planning, for the singing from balconies by other communities, for the recognition that isolation doesn't need to mean loneliness, for the notes through letterboxes offering help and support, for the internet and telephones and technology that connects, for the awakened appreciation of what is truly important. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done.
On earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day
our daily bread.
Forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those
who sin against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
the power and the glory,
forever and ever.
So, we're going to have our final prayer, or our collect, where we collect everything in this service together. And I'm going to ask people to stand up for this, actually, because we've got some actions. I think we can do those in a socially distanced way. I'm going to socially distance myself from Debbie, who I've been, warned I'm too close to. Right, so... Paul says we should have the same mind as Jesus. So, God, we ask you to help us to walk like Jesus. And we say together, walk like Jesus. And we mind walking. Talk like Jesus. And we say together, talk like Jesus. Think like Jesus. And we say together, think like Jesus. Very good, very good. And love like Jesus. And we say together, love like Jesus. Okay, let's do all four of those again. We walk like Jesus. We talk like Jesus. We think like Jesus. Oh, we missed one, didn't we? We live like Jesus. And we love like Jesus. That's great. Okay, so we can stay standing because we've got another song now, which you'll know. He's got the whole world in his hands. Do we know that one? Okay, we love that one, don't we? I might try and do some actions for that if I've got a mind to it. So we'll stand for that. We'll continue standing for that, but let's not run around if we can avoid it. That's what we've got to try and avoid. Okay, Rob. Thank you very, you can sit down actually. Thank you very much for coming this morning. It's great to see everybody. Remember your school forms, they come in next week on the 4th. We get them back to you, the hard copy ones, which Archbishop Blanche, St. Margaret's and King David, hard copies. you need to bring them next Sunday and give them to Karen White, because Karen, as church warden, handles the registers. Because, you know, I'm not here every week, so I don't know who is here and who is not here, because I'm not here. So Karen and Rob do that for us. They take the registers. So if you give them to Karen White next week, or by the 4th, and we'll give them back to you on the 11th, okay? And the St Hilda's form, you'll need to send directly to Karen White. Don't send things to me, because you probably worked out I've got a brain like a sieve, and it's more likely to get lost. But Karen has got the gift of administration, which is something that has eluded me. Okay, so if you send them to her, get everything to Karen, she'll sort it out. I'll sign them, we'll give them back to you. You'll have a record of your attendance at Children's Church or here at church. So thanks very much. And it's harvest next week. May we go, Lord God, to meet the needs of others and share the love we have from you. The Lord bless you and bless us and preserve us from all evil and keep us in eternal life. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hello. Over recent months, we have done our best to keep you informed of the financial challenge we are facing to bridge our income gap, sustain our buildings and clergy, as well as our mission and ministry within the local community. Little did we know when we began this process, which we have called Stepping Up to the Plate, of the further challenge we would be faced with due to COVID-19. As our church buildings have been closed for the past few months, we have lost regular rental income from the church hall in Belgrave Road, as well as collections from our church services. The work of our church is reliant on people's generosity. We do not receive anything in the way of funds from the diocese. If you feel that you are in a position to help, there are many ways you can do so. Some people give through the parish giving scheme. One can also give through by direct debit or a one-off payment. Details of how you can do this will be on the following slide. Thank you so much for your generosity and your support of the church in so many different ways. God bless you.